Myasthenia Gravis, Systematic Review, Thoracic Masterclass. In this lecture presentation, investigations, classifications, different treatment modalities and thymectomy are reviewed according to the latest published data.
Myasthenia Gravis is a rare autoimmune disease caused by autoantibodies to the postsynaptic site of the neuromuscular junction that induces weakness and fatigability of the skeletal muscles. This characterized by fluctuating muscle weakness that worsens with activity and improves on rest. 50% of patients initially presented with ocular symptoms, with or without generalized weakness. 10% of patients are termed refractory, either experiencing frequent relapses upon lowering the immune therapy, or remaining clinically unstable under immunotherapeutic treatment regimen. Epidemiology, sex, and age appear to influence the occurrence of the disease. Presentation below the age of 40 shows a female predominance in a ratio of 3 to 1, between 40 and 50 years, and as well as during puberty, sex is roughly equal. Above 50 of age male gender are commonest.
Presentation, myasthenia gravis has different forms, and its impact on patients' daily life depends on symptom severity, and on muscle involvement, which is usually categorized as ocular, in 85% of patients, and progress in 50% to generalized form, presenting with ptosis, and diplopia, generalized form which affects proximal muscles more than distal ones, the upper limbs more than the lower limbs head muscle and may lead to head drooping. Bulbiform can be seen in 60% of patients, presenting with a nasal tone, dysarthria, dysphagia, respiratory form, which is rare as the initial presentation, however usually occurs within 2 years of onset, and may lead to respiratory failure.
Clinical classification of the disease either utilizing a Osman classification, or the Myasthenia Gravis Foundation of America, this classification, are essential for disease severity, follow-up, and research. The Osman classification shows for classes according to the involvement of the different presentation, class 1, only ocular involvement, class 2a, generalized muscle involvement, without pulmonary involvement, class 2b, bulbar manifestation, class 3, rapid progression of generalized bulbar disease, and weakness in respiratory muscles, class 4, in which class 1 or 2 patients presenting progressive symptoms within 2 years.
The MGFA, clinical classification, in this classification, the different disease presentations, progression and severity are categorized into 5 classes. Diagnostic tests, and investigations, upon investigating a case of myasthenia gravis, confirmation of diagnosis, exclusion of thymoma, and assessment for operability is the aim. For diagnostic purposes, tensilin tests, erythropoietin chloride, and ice pack tests were historically done. In current practice, electrophysiological studies, including repetitive nerve stimulation study, showing more than 10% decremental loss of action potential, or using single fiber electromyography denoting variability in time of the second action potential relative to the first's, and the use of immunological tests, including anti-acetylcholine receptors antibody, anti-MuSK antibody, and others as statin, ryanodine receptors, in thymoma are diagnostic tools, contrast CT to rule out thymoma, or MRI scans to rule out vascular invasion are additional crucial tools in the diagnostic battery. Functional vital capacity as a pulmonary function test is essential before thymectomy.
There are two approaches for the management of a case of myasthenia gravis, based on the physiology of the disease. The first is by increasing the amount of acetylcholine that is available to bind with the postsynaptic receptor, using an acetylcholinesterase inhibitor. The second is by using immunosuppressive medication that decrease the binding of acetylcholine receptors by antibodies.
Summary of treatment, symptomatic treatment with acetylcholinesterase inhibitors, LEPID short-term immunomodulating treatment, with plasmapheresis, and intravenous immunoglobulin, chronic long-term immunomodulating treatment, with glucocorticoids, and other immunosuppressant drugs, and thymectomy.
Acetylcholinesterase inhibitors are used as a symptomatic therapy and act by increasing the amount of available ACTH at the neuromuscular junction. Pyridostigmine is the most commonly used drug. It shows a rapid action within 15 to 30 minutes and reaching a peak in 2 hours and lasting for up to 4 hours. The usual oral dose is between 15 to 30 milligrams every 4 to 6 hours. It shows some side effects including abdominal cramps, diarrhea, sweating, and bradycardia, skeletal muscle for circulations, and cramping are due to its nicotinic side effect.
Short-term immunomodulating therapy, including plasmapheresis and intravenous immunoglobulins, plasmapheresis shows improved strength in most patients by direct removal of the circulating obnoxious antibodies. Typically one exchange is done every other day for a total of 4 to 6 times. Some adverse effects including hypertension, infections, thrombotic, and bleeding tendency is due to decreased circulating coagulation factors. Intravenous immunoglobulin shows a complex mechanism of action, however they remove the pathogenic antibodies utilizing immunoadsorption mechanism. Due to the rapid action, they are used during crisis, worsening symptoms while on medical therapy, or as preparation for thymectomy.
Long-term immune therapy, this includes corticosteroids, and immunosuppressant. The goal of immune-directed therapy is to induce remission, or near remission of symptoms and maintain it. Prednisone is generally used when symptoms of myasthenia gravis are not adequately controlled by cholinesterase inhibitors alone. Good response can be achieved with initial higher doses, and then tapering it to the lowest dose to maintain the response. In the ocular form, oral prednisone is more effective. A list of immunosuppressant drugs are used mostly as steroid-sparing drugs, and includes the famous azathioprine.
Surgical option, thymectomy, the indications, timing, preoperative consideration, approaches, contraindications, and complications of surgery will be discussed.
Before embarking into thymectomy, the following checklist should be carefully addressed, and this includes understanding that involved muscles, is it a generalized or ocular form, the onset of age with early or late, the presence of poor absence of antibodies, and which type, the presence or absence of thymoma.
The indications for thymectomy includes thymomatous myasthenia gravis and non-thymomatous myasthenia gravis with anti-acetylcholine antibody positive titer. In practice, 5 scenarios may be seen, including juvenile myasthenia gravis with HAB positive titer. Surgical option is indicated in these cases only if failed or the need to avoid complications of medical treatment. In this group of patients, post-pubertal involution of the thymus gland brings many of them into remission. Elderly, surgery is contraindicated above the age of 60, and this is due to expected atrophy of the gland. Ocular type. This is a controversial issue among the medical schools. Some authors contraindicate the procedures, while others offer minimal invasive approach, with the aim to prevent the 50% of patients that will suffer generalized form after 2 years of onset. MASCAB positive and seronegative myasthenia gravis, patients who are acetylcholine antibody negative. While MASCAB positive are not recommended for surgery, except patients who suffer thymoma, however, double seronegative are considered for operation. Myasthenia gravis during pregnancy, surgery should be postponed until post-pregnancy, because it is unlikely to be beneficial.
Timing for surgery, in non-thymomatous patients, surgery is an elective procedure, and hence should only be done in stable patients, between 16 to 60 years old, unless special consideration. Although early thymectomy does not have proven benefits, it is mostly recommended within the first 3 years of the disease. In thymomatous patients, it should be done urgently after preoperative preparation.
Preoperative preparation, assess patient's symptom severity, including bulbar and respiratory symptoms. If present, it should postpone surgery. Assess contrast CT scan and MRI to exclude thymoma, and if present, to exclude vascular invasion. Pulmonary function tests, the most important is the functional vital capacity. Assess medication, patient should reduce their steroid dose as much as possible. Preoperative plasma exchange, or IV immunoglobulin, should be arranged for patients presenting with bulbar and or respiratory symptoms. Continuation of regular anticholinesterase treatments until surgery, and even giving the last drug dose in morning of operation day is very important, as well as when the patient regains his consciousness.
Surgical approaches. There are several approaches to perform thymectomy, and this includes transcervical, transsternal, combined transcervical, and transsternal, minimal invasive thymectomy utilizing video or robotic assisted. All procedures perform thymectomy. However, reports from minimally invasive techniques shows low morbidity, short hospital stay, patient satisfaction with equivalent clinical outcome.
Outcome after thymectomy versus medical treatment was subjected to many reports. Until 2016, a randomized trial showed the following results. patient who underwent surgery showed significant improvement in their myasthenia symptom score, reduced steroid requirements, as well as immune suppression, and hospitalization for exacerbation. The benefit of thymectomy, however, does not start very quickly. Remission rates in the first year are less than 20%. However, this rate climbs up to 50% over 7 to 10 years post-procedure.